And our next talk is by Nicolas Maximiliano Martin Fontana. I hope I got all of those right.
Yeah, he's fine. Yeah. Okay. Nicolas is fine. Yeah.
And it's about how to improve and grow a company.
Exactly. Well, I will start sharing my screen, okay?
Go ahead. Good. You got it. We see it.
Okay. So, well, my name is Nicolas. I've been in the translation industry since 2011. I was involved in several big companies, like one of them, Lionbridge, then Jensen Localization, and nowadays in Comunica. And I was involved in business development roles, vendor management, language leading. I was a translator, a test engineer also. And thanks to 2020, I had enough time to sum up all my experience in this presentation, and also including some books that I have time to read, and I will recommend at the end of the presentation. If you have questions, I will take them at the end of the presentation, or if there won't be enough time, you can contact me by LinkedIn. I will provide my profile at the end. So let's start. So time is the most important thing in any company. Even though you are a one person company, you have to follow certain tips, like do it once, meaning that if you take any action or task, you have to take care of this action from the beginning till the end, even if difficult one. You have to divide your day per actions that you need to take, and always there is impossible to complete all tasks you may have in a company or as a freelancer. So you have to choose at least 6 of the most important tasks daily and complete them. Setting completion time for tasks, well, this is a bit harder, but you should allocate a specific time. I know that, well, when translating, there is sometimes you can do an estimation of the time you will need, but you never know if you would be interrupted or not. And for this, each of any task you can take from translation to, for example, planning calls with clients and so on, you have to consider a gap of interruption. So in these 8 hours or 10 hours or 6 hours you are planning to work, you should always have in mind to save time for interruptions, and consider these interruptions as a normal part of your daily schedule. Doing complex tasks first, well, is as if you were attending the Anna Lebot's presentation, is very important to not only focus on the task you like, but do also important tasks, complex one. And if you start one of these tasks, do it till the end. For example, a negotiation or an important call with a client or attending a bad feedback. All of this is part of any business development, even for a very small or one person company. About storing information, well, as most of you know, in Europe we have this GDPR law that is about handling personal information. So it's very important nowadays not to store information that you are not going to use. Not only information that won't be useful, but delicate information that if you are already done with a project, then have this technique of always deleting the information you won't need any longer. Only keep important information, for example, financial, that you will require for maybe for some task declaration or accounting, but always keep your laptop, telephone, PC clean, like you do with your house, do the same with information. Then training is a very important part of creation or the upgrade of a company or even a startup. If you start like first you start as a freelancer, then maybe a colleague is joining you, then you are growing little by little. And the most important part of growing is learning. As it says here, knowledge is power. And if you learn and you acquire new techniques and refresh your technological background, this is always a good way to help you. For a smaller, medium, and big companies, it is very important to train new employees and has a procedure to do so. For small, medium size, and big companies, it's important to retrain and to retain all employees. Why? Because all employees, even though there could be sometimes difficult to learn, they may have difficulties to learn new technology. It's important because they have the background of the progress of this industry, because it's not the same the industry as it was in the 90s and is nowadays. At the beginning, I have some anecdotes from business owners that translation was all done by faxing the material. Nowadays, well, there are a few companies that use faxing or fax machines to receive a source text and deliver the translation. Then it's very important to provide a professional development. This is more applicable to medium-sized companies, because otherwise people tend to get bored. So you have to give them an aim in your company and a constant path and development flow. Otherwise they will stay in they will feel like they are in a hole and they do only repetitive tasks. You have to try to, if you have, let's say, a team of translators, try to give them different fields to develop in, not only focus in one, but try to offer them to develop in others fields also. Create solutions means that every company or even a freelance always has issues. So each issue should be accompanied by a procedure on how to solve it. So as soon as you have a solution for any issue, you have to set this in a procedure. Like, this was my problem. Let's say back in 2018, I found this solution and it's working. So I keep doing things this way, because improving, you can improve maybe 1, 2, 3 times. But if you base a company on only finding a short fix or a quick fix, then it will be difficult to progress and grow. Improve performance is related to create solutions. You have to, for improving your performance, you have to have solutions for every problem. And to own the future, the only way is to train, learn, and be technologically advanced. So embrace new technologies, like Joseph in the previous speech says machine translation is here to stay. It's not something that would, in my personal view, it won't challenge the capacity of a human translator. It would become a tool, and probably translators will be called in other ways in the future, like reviewers, linguists, and so on, and maybe would be less of a present of like a translation only, or it would be even a linguistic advisor, but there would be a mutation and a progression of the work positions, but there won't be a extinction of the position. So we have to learn to live with this new technology, learn how to use it, and use it in our advantage, and not fearing. There is nothing to fear, because technology is made by humans and we can control it. Then another important part is to plan and have everything regulated, written in procedures. There are many companies, it may sound crazy, but there are medium-sized companies that I think someone has a mic open. Anna Horstein? Ah, okay. Thank you. Thank you. So even though it seems crazy, some medium-sized company, they don't have procedures. So imagine you have a new person arriving to your company, and they have to find a way to, how is the proper way to answer an email, and you tell the person, ah, okay, I don't know, do it as you wish, because we always improvise, we don't have anything written. So avoid this way of doing things, because it can turn your company in a very chaotic workflow. Even if you are a one-person company, remember, is very important to have everything written down and in procedures. And this is related to thinking, and how you think is important. If you think like a big company and you see yourself in the future, it doesn't matter that you are two persons or three or four in the company. You have to see yourself like you are a corporation. Even though you are small, there is no there is not a barrier for progressing by being small. And the other important thing is that you have to trust your colleagues and the co-workers you have, or the people who are helping you to build this company. Even you are starting from a very small team, you have to let others find solutions and listen to their ideas and suggestions, and try to find a way to use them to progress. And once you find this way, with this, you have to unite a path or a vision to keep on progressing and growing and getting wealthier. And then once you have all written down in procedures and paper, you have to monitor them and check if they really work, meaning if they are applicable to real life situations. Because sometimes procedures, they change. It's not the same a procedure made in, let's say, a couple of years ago. I will put a real example, okay? A couple of years ago, LSP, an agency, was using in-house CRM program to follow up with clients and so on. But then they decide to move to a new software, more a common one, like XTRF could be, or PluNet. And then these procedures will have to adapt to this new tool. So you have to keep on improving the procedures and testing. Once a procedure is getting obsolete, you have to get rid of this procedure and create a new one. And this is creating a situation where you have to measure results. So you measure results with your coworkers or employees by checking if their productivity with these procedures is the appropriate one. And if these results are positive, then of course you should reward these people who are following the procedures and are getting the job done or complete. So it is very important to have everything written down and everything compiled to create the perfect path for your company development. Meetings is another important point. They must be held regularly. If you are having to meet, let's say the ideal will be weekly, but you have to keep the meetings short and avoid making them boring or not interesting. What I mean is, it's better to have a meeting where you can speak with the other person and share the knowledge, not a monologue. Let's say, because if you only hold meetings to create a monologue where one person is leading, then it could be non-productive. All the meetings should be in a kind of workshop style, meaning that you have to interact with each member of the meeting. In these meetings, there should be a list of issues to address. Usually the list of issues can be quite long. As bigger you grow, the bigger the list of issues will be. So you will have to measure time and schedule, let's say, find which one is the most important to address. If you have a team, set names next to each task and issue to be solved, and let people work together to solve the issues. Then it's very important, well, as the companies are growing, to have in these meetings summaries for each meeting, because this will be like a guide for the next meeting to know what you were talking about, if what you discussed was solved or not, or if it needed to be addressed again, and if it needed to be follow up. So having summaries is really important, and is also crucial that you involve different people to write summaries. Not always the same people, not always the same person should write the summary. It should be rotated, because it's a very important skill for any company, or any potential company agency that would like to grow. And finally, at to-dos to each person, to each of the members taking part of the meeting, and follow up with them. Ask them if how the situation is going with the problem you gave them to solve, and note down the findouts, the solutions, and turn them into procedures. A strategy, well, here you can find some tips that I gather. It's very important to find data about the market. What I would recommend is to consult NIMSI, Slater, CSA Research, subscribe to multilingual magazine, attend to conferences, like in this case, your organization for your field, but do not keep yourself in the same circle. Try to move around. Imagine if you stay only in the Israel Translation Association, then your pool of potential clients will be reduced. But if you move around different events, conference and associations, then your pool and options and opportunities will grow. So it's very important that a freelance translator or a small business owner joins different conference, like from ATA from the US, or you have ATC in the United Kingdom, or any other conference you could be interested, where your skills can be useful. Let's say that you speak Hebrew, but you also speak as a second language Finnish, so you can translate from Finnish to Hebrew. So then I would recommend you to join NTF, that is a Nordic Translation Industry Forum, and so on so forth. Then you have two ways of growing or planning. You have the tactic and the strategy. The tactic is a short-term action. For example, sending an email to get a lead. The strategy is a composition of different tactics that it will take you to your final goal, that will be making 1 million euro per year. For example, that will be your final goal. To reach that goal, you will need a lot of different tactics together. Another important thing are investing in sales training and salespeople. If you don't like sales, most people don't, you have to keep in mind that even it would sound a bit capitalist in the way that I would say, is the system we are living in. So each one of us is on sale and has to sell and has something to sell. So we must learn how to do it properly. If we are not able to do it properly, or if it's something that we hate or we don't like, we have to hire people to do so. In this case, well, nowadays there is a very little companies or little LSPs that call their the salesperson sales manager. It's a tendency to change this. They are trying to focus more on business development, on customer management or account management. But in the end, all of this is related to sales, and you have to learn the proper way to do it. In the end of this presentation, I will provide a few very important books that I would highly recommend that you buy and read them. Even some of them you can get for free, and I will provide you where you can get them for free. Then, talking about clients, that is important for a strategy. Here is a constant evolution, because before, in the past, it was enough to present your service and let's say, well, I do translation from this language to that language. My price is this one. Please contact me at this website or email or this telephone, etc. This was maybe 20 years ago, the easy way, and it was working for most people. But nowadays, clients are getting more and more demanding, and they are trying to understand more things. So we need to help them to understand more. And how we do that? By training them, because not all the clients understand the necessity of a proper translation, because nowadays they are bombarded with so many different ways of having their source text translated, that they don't know what to choose or why they should choose this. Why they should, I don't know. I will put you an example in Spain. In Spain is a huge problem because there are a lot of companies who think that Google Translate is the best way to do a translation if you don't have a budget. And what they do, they translate their website, everything using Google Translate, and they send it to their marketing campaign, they apply to the website, and then there is a total disaster, you know, when you get these things. And usually then they contact an agency or a translator telling, oh, look, I have this problem, I have a misunderstanding with my clients, and now I don't know what to do, can you help me? And this is where the humans, or we, or the people who is able to think, and not only Google Translate or any other automatic translation tool, this is the place for us to explain the client why they should be wise and use a person with knowledge. And this is what we have to do. Provide the right pitch, explaining them, educating them with a lot of comprehension, because sometimes you can feel really upset and frustrated. I can give you an example, a real life example from my side. I used to work for a big automotive company who didn't understand the differences of Spanish, because I used to work translating to Argentinian Spanish. But no, this company, they wanted to create the US Spanish, and they think that the proper way of doing it was mixing some words in English and some words in Spanish, because that's the way the Spanish people in America are talking in USA, no? And it was very hard to make these top managers from this automotive company understand that there is not such a US Spanish. It doesn't exist. There is the original, okay, the Royal Academy of the Spanish language, and then there are different linguistic variations according to the country. But in Spain, in US, there is no any Spanish from US. So you have to try to calm and explain in the most appropriate way to the client, so to reach a solution. And become a market expert in what you do, with the proper explanation, with being calm, with, I know it's difficult, but not getting frustrated. And making the people who are not understanding fully the translation industry and what we are doing, to enlighten them, you know, to open their eyes and to show them that, well, there are things that are not easily solved with a Google Translate or with mixing some English words into Spanish to create a language that in reality doesn't exist. And the final part of a strategy is being able to find trends. Trends are similar to, if you know something about aeronautics, there are some air currents that the planes are taking to go faster from point A to B. So this is a trend. A trend is something that is not profitable yet, but it will be. For example, in 2017, no one think that it will happen, this pandemic, and we will all end up working from home. So imagine if you, let's say, were able to know that this this would become into a trend and everyone will end up working at home and using several different video conferencing tools like Zoom. If you find this trend in the right time, let's say on March 2020, you would say, oh, I will invest in conferencing tools. I will approach new developers who are translating their app into different languages, and I will stay with them because they will grow. So this is very important in a strategy. Read the newspaper, or I would recommend online, but I know that maybe some people are still reading magazines, newspapers, and so on and so forth. But by reading and absorbing what's going on in your environment and the news, you can find trends. For example, another example, in Spain, this year, it was a kind of advice that it would be the worst winter, 2020-2021 winter. So there was a huge amount of people investing in a snow material, like shovels and better clothing, and there were a lot of companies thinking about this, and they were right. There was a huge cold wave that did last around 1 month and a half, and it create a peak on sales for these companies who were producing these products for this type of climate. That is something that no one believes. Come on, in Spain, everyone thinks that it's sunny, well, most of the time, and so on and so forth. But not this year. We have proven that this trend, for the people who discovered this trend, was a very profitable idea. So it's very important to find these specific areas where you can get profit. And how you do that? By read news, follow the media. Okay, another big important thing is to find the right person for your company when you are growing and when you are already a well-established one. Ace people are those people who are out of the normal standard working environment. They usually are people who are very productive, meaning productive in the way that they produce money in the, let's say, I'm talking in the capitalist way all the time, because it's what makes company grow. And what you have to do is to hire the best of them. To hire the best of them, you will need a certain tools to learn. The learning, it would be the first point, you should state the three objectives you would like to have for your company. Let's say, I would like to have 50,000 euro per year profit. I would like to have an office in Spain. I would like to grow a team of a fixed translator. Fixed meaning French, Italian, German, Spanish. And next to this, you should add the amount of money you are willing to pay for this. And if you don't have this money now, then offer some kind of reward schedule. The reward table will consist on offering a bonus or a commission or some kind of partnership. Many companies, they grow from a micro or a small company to a medium size in this way. Why? Because let's say that you would like to grow because you have more and more work and you offer a new translator or a translator you already know. You offer this person, okay, look, I can give you this money now. I know it's not too much, but if we manage to reach this goal, I can make you a partner. And we both would be the owners of the company. And in that way, it's a good way to invest in a lot or having to ask for a credit or a loan. The other important thing is that you use different tests to, if you are already consolidated and you are looking for people, you should ask some advice on how to find the right people, because the problem is that maybe you find a person you think is the right one, but then it will turn out that it's not, and it's a rotten apple, and then it will destroy your company completely. So for this, you need to use a certain method like DISC. I can provide more information at the end because it's quite a long methods for targeting new employees. Then the next step when you hire someone or you add someone to your company is to test this person and rate, meaning that you have to keep following up with the person, see how it improves and so on till it reach the goal you set. You will find some people who are called, let's say, in this definition of ace, most ace are having a bravado. Bravado is a person who is very powerful and pushing, always for better and growing and so on. These people is the ones that are helping companies to grow. Are people who are not getting only, they don't have enough with the task. They want to do more, they want to learn more, they want to know everything about your company, even though you would think that, well, why they are looking to know so much? But the thing is that a person, when you find the right person who want to grow...
Mayush, you want to give a prize or something?
Sorry?
Can you see my mute, please?
Okay. Okay, so I keep on going. Okay, I want you, once you find these people, you have to reward them accordingly and build a team. You cannot expect to have one people who would do everything for you. You have to build a team, learn from these people and work together. That's the best way to reach the goal. The best buyer or your best client is the one you dream of. Usually the dream client is this client who will pay you on time, who will give you more jobs, the one who will appreciate your work, and they will give you a good feedback. They will present a proper feedback if you did something wrong without insulting you. So these are the clients you have to focus. I know they are difficult to find, but it's possible. As I said before, an important thing to capture this type of clients is to provide them free education. Education meaning to make them understand why it's important translation in their production cycle. that translation is not something that can be taken like, okay, the cheapest, the possible faster, and we deliver the product, and then you have some medical device that it will be a total disaster because the translation from English to Hebrew was not done properly, and the person using this medical device in the hospital is not understanding anything and not even knowing how to use it properly. So you had to use fear as motivator. You had to tell the client, look, if you do the things wrong, the outcome will be very bad for your reputation and your product. You, while doing this, well, never lie, always be honest. You can, of course, decorate the reality with some nice words and proper explanation, but always attach to the reality and be honest is the best way to gain clients and to gain these dream ones. You have to create a story about you, and you have to create a presentation and information and credibility. This is the pitch you should give to these potential clients. Always give useful information and do not only focus on the sales part. The sales part should be the last part of the pitch. Because if you provide useful data, you will get the client. Doesn't matter if you put medals on your on yourself saying that you, I don't know, you translated for NASA. So get their attention. Their attention can be attracted by, you can do reductions like discounts. However, I don't recommend to offer discounts, but some people does. It's a part of a strategy. I would recommend better to give some gifts in the way of a market analysis or showing your client that you know who they are, the competitors. To give you a real example, if I would like to take a product, let's say a mouse that is produced in Spain, and I would like to sell this mouse in Israel, you should know that you should buy to the, this client, okay, in Israel you will have these competitors that produce similar mouse that you are producing, and these are their prices. And I think for this and this reason that your product could be accepted or not. This is very useful for end clients. And I can assure you that you will get their attention if you do this, if you do things like this. Follow up, meaning that you have to keep a consistent communication with the client. If they ignore your emails, let's say that you would like to work with Porsche, no, because you have a huge knowledge in automotive translation. Do not send only one email, and if you don't get an answer, stop. No, you have to send one email. If you don't get an answer, find their influencers in LinkedIn, go to the marketing manager. If the marketing manager doesn't accept your connection request, move to translation manager, move to the CEO, and look for each of the decision makers that are present in the company. Persist, use perseverance, and at the end, you will get two optional answers. They will tell you, look, we know you. Now you contact almost half of our company. We know your name. We don't need your services. Thank you. They can be rude sometimes, but it's better to get an answer than don't get any answer. And the other possibility is that they will say, yes, we need your services. Thank you for contacting half of our company. And this is, I can tell you, is the only strategy that will make you succeed at finding the right client for you. Then about affiliate marketing and gain referrals, affiliate marketing refers to talking at conferences, refers to sponsoring at conferences. This is what it means affiliate. You go with someone else or with a translation association, you get your name attached to this association or to this conference, and then in this way you get visibility. And by getting visibility, people will be curious about you and Google your name, try to search you at LinkedIn or at Xing, that is a German professional social media, similar to LinkedIn or any other professional platform. In Poland, there is another one that is not popular European-wide, but in Poland is very, very well known, and it's called Golden Line. No, and it's also for professionals, just to give you an example. And gain referrals means that, well, you have to gain these good words from your client or good words from your translators and use them to gain visibility and promote your services. In the case of translators, well, the comments could be in proset.com, or in the case of clients, in your LinkedIn profile or your website, get them to write you some nice things, or if they write you some nice feedback, always you can ask, look, can I put this in my website, or can you write me a recommendation at LinkedIn? This is highly important to gain visibility. Marketing. Well, I will try to go a bit faster because time is running. You have a lot of ways to do marketing. The most important one nowadays, and due to this pandemic we are living in, is internet. So you have to focus on a proper creation of visibility in internet. If you need help with social media on how to grow on internet, find someone who is specialized in this. It's better than you making attempts of creating profiles and doing some ad hoc testing, because at the end you will spend a lot of your time that is valuable with zero results. So what I would recommend is to contact someone that is specialized in this, at least hire this person or pay for their service for a while till you learn about them. And once you learn, then do it yourself or hire someone to do it. The other thing, as I mentioned several times since the beginning, is education. Do webinars, trainings, offer knowledge, because one of the things that attracts clients or other translators is knowledge, because knowledge is power nowadays. As much as you know, the more power you have. Personal contact. Well, even nowadays in the situation we have, there are very, very few events taking place live. You need a face to present, even though you are video conferencing. So it's important to keep this human touch. If you create a website, put a photo of yourself, a description. Do not make a website who is completely completely without any human touch, that there are no photos, there are not about you, there is no information. So try to avoid doing a website saying, I translate from X language to Y language. My fare is this one. I'm the best. My quality is the best. My price is the cheapest, or things like that, without adding any human touch. in this case, the other part, corporate literature is for medium to bigger size companies. This is the creation of brochures, presentations that they have to keep the same style that you want to give your company. I will put a very easy example so it's easy to understand. If your company color will be yellow, just keep all your material in yellow, because this is how you create your branding. And this is how you will be remembered, because most of people do not remember words or what is written mostly, but they remember figures, logos, colors. This is something that stay longer in our brains. And then the other two missing parts of marketing is direct mail, that nowadays is not useful because in several countries there are restrictions for mail, because there are some authorities mail or paper material can convey or can contain coronavirus. So some countries are restricting this direct mail. And advertising in the old way, well, using banners and so on to pay in a street could be useful if you want to focus on a very specific area. But what I would do nowadays is advertise, but in social media. Facebook is one of the most popular places to advertise, and the one where you can get more ROI, meaning return of investment, or Google Ads, or LinkedIn is growing slowly. However, not many people like seeing ads in LinkedIn. It's a bit annoying, because the platform was not created for advertisement, even though it's kind of evolving to have some advertisement time or space, let's say. Okay, executive briefing. Executive briefing is about the presentation you do of a company or your services. It's very important to use visual eyes, as I said before, colors. The human figure is very attractive. If you want, I can provide a list of colors. You can contact me at the end or in the following days, and I can provide more information about this. You have to know your material almost, I won't say by memory, but know as it would be your favorite story, you know, or tale. Then there are certain rules for presenting that unfortunately nowadays they don't apply, because they are rules for real life events. For virtual events, the rules are being made as we are talking now. So basically, you have to adapt to the event. Well, you can see me that I'm dressing with a shirt and some kind of pullover, but it's not very visible. So I could be dressing with a blouse and it won't make much difference. In a real conference, it will. So you have to always adapt or check how the previous conference were and how was the dress code. So this is important when attending a conference. In virtual, as I said, the rules are more flexible a bit. Of course, you cannot present naked. No? It would be a bit uncomfortable and cold. No? So the words, tone, and body language, again, is applicable for real life conferences, because I won't be able to be standing up or moving or dancing here while talking here in Zoom. So this is only applicable for real life conference. errors when presenting, well, not knowing what you're presenting, reading, also staying in silence, in complete silence, and looking like, oh my goodness, I forgot everything that I was preparing, no? And then, well, you are in deep shit, let's say, in a bad way, no? And areas to cover, well, be aware to cover areas that are interesting and applying to your industry. If you are talking about translation, in this case, you talk about translation, about business in translation. If, let's say, you go to France to automotive conference, then, well, try to talk about automotive and the relation to translation. This is quite easy and logic. You always have to prepare your presentation to where you are going. If you want to gain clients of the air industry, well, give examples about that. Well, ideal prospect related to a prospect is the lead or the seed before turning into a client. So you have to create a description of this ideal program. Ideal prospect, okay? And be persistent. If you want to, if you really like, let's say, games, well, go for the games companies. If you fail, don't say, okay, now I will change to farm, to agriculture. I don't know anything, but a friend told me that it could be something interesting and they are looking for translators. No, try to focus to something you know. If you want to focus to something else, try to learn a bit before and then move to the next one. But doing many things, like if you were an octopus, it would only end in disaster. So, as I say, make a list of your ideal, in this case, it's called prospect, but it will be clients as a prospect change to client when talking in a pipeline, in a sales pipeline, no? Every client starts as a prospect. Give them a small gift like training, education, as we said before. Write them a letter, congratulate them for their birthday, for Christmas, Hanukkah, if they are in China, make them aware that you know that there is a difference between the new Chinese year and the different from other different country or religion. Follow up, do not leave them thinking that, hey, come on, this person sent me an email a month ago and now it's total silence. Be always the first on following up. Do not wait till the client answer. If of course takes a week, wait for a week. I don't mean that you should follow up an hour later of sending an email. Just wait a week, wait 2 weeks, a month maximum, but don't wait a year because otherwise the client would lose total interest. Keep a tone of authority means that you have to, even though they don't understand your point of view, as I said about the US Spanish, tell them that you know that there is no US Spanish. And these are the reasons why. Be an authority of what you are doing. And as previously said, use the executive briefing, that is a presentation. And the presentation should be adapted to this prospect. Sales. Well, as said before in previous slides, sales is something that not everyone likes, but is very necessary. But if you need to hire a person for sales, do not expect that this person would be Superman or Superwoman. You have to help them. work them together, make sales work with your production and with marketing all together, should form a team, and in that way everything would be fine. You have to find needs. So I'm talking about the clients. So always ask questions. Do not leave a, if you have questions, ask. There is no bad question. It's better to ask than don't ask. So you have to motivate your buyers by following up with them and overcome the obstacles they will put you. They will say, well, you are too expensive. Well, but I can do it cheaper in this way, and so on and so forth. So create a possible outcomes. Let's say, if a client is telling you, no, but I have some other person who do it half of your price. And you can say, well, yes, but this other person can give you a guarantee of money back if they do a bad job? Or do you know if they use machine translation only? How they explain you the translation process? Are they going to use a human translator? And things like that. You have to pick in the client's brain. So to make them doubt. Because I work for a translation company currently that provide Nordic languages. And there are other providers in China who provide Nordic languages. And they do for 5 cents per word. And I can tell you that it's impossible to find a human Nordic translator who charge 5 cents per word. So I'm sure they are using machine translation to provide this service. So make your client tell you what the other person is offering them to get this price that sometimes could be ridiculous, no, the prices they are offering. And close the sale by assuming it, like, okay, when do they start? Okay, send me a sample, or, okay, I have next week, I full available. Please send me the project. So think that you already have the project. And follow up, as I said before, follow up and follow up. Keep the client happy, no? By following up, communicating, bond with them, build trust, respect, show them that you know. Collect useful information, ask your client how is their process, what the problems they have, what are their aims, which are their dream clients. Ask your client which are their dreams, what they want to reach, and help them reach that dream with the translation. Share tips with them, interesting facts. If you have an opportunity, let's say related to your client, share it. Look, maybe you can invest here. I know that, let's say that you are working with Ford and you know that there is a company in Israel that is going bankrupt and they are building cars there. And you can tell your client, look, in Israel, we have this factory that is closing down. Maybe you could invest, maybe you could expand here. Not only focus on your services, but focus on trying to give this extra to the client to keep their attention. And as I said before, send them emails, letter, gifts, cards for holidays time, for birthday. Keep their attention. Offer them to succeed and they will make you succeed. Invite them to your house or your offices, or get them to know each other better. I know that nowadays is almost impossible this, but well, you can ask them to to have a video conference with you, and you can show them something. Oh, look, here is my view from my window, from my office, or look, here is my child, my daughter, my etc. Show them that you are human, and that you are real. Because some clients, they only think that a translator is only a part of their business, and it's not. It's another human being, like every one of us. Even a salesperson is a human being. So, and we'll set goals, and there are a few here tips that you can use to reach your goal. One is a very common phrase that is fake it till you make it. Make it, it means that you have to persevere and reach the goal you want. If you don't have the knowledge, learn and keep on persevering. Keep a positive attitude. I know it's not easy nowadays, and we, most of us, we have some issues, some family who are with COVID or died, or struggling economically, or doesn't have enough income, etc. But try to think positive and find the things, the good things, the trends that are creating this situation. For example, the boom in video conferencing tools. Stay focused on success. Keep track of all the things you do, even if you have to do it in Excel. There is no need of investment in highly technological tools. There are many tools free if you want to grow, like Trello, that is quite similar to a to-do list that it will help you to succeed and keep following up and track of all your actions. Keep a discipline and make a kind of a competition this growing. If you are growing among a team or two persons or even yourself, set rewards to you. If I manage to reach this goal, I will go and eat sushi, or I will go and eat something I like, or I will buy, I don't know, a bike, a car, etc. And above all, even though I know it may sound crazy, there is a system that we have as humans that is called RAS, that is reticular activating system, that it will keep all these ideas and problems we have every day. We will have these problems in our mind, and every time we go to sleep, this RAS will do some magic, and the next day you will have some solutions. So that's why you should sleep over on some problems or some decisions. So take some time to decide. And as I promised at the beginning, sorry for the delay in finishing, these are the books I will recommend you to buy or to buy and read. The Ultimate Sales Machine, you will have to buy it. Never Say Sell, you can get it for free. I think I can provide a link. The General Theory of the Translation Company is a book from Renato Beninato and Tucker, that they are the creators of NIMSI. It's a really good book if you want to turn your freelance business into a small or medium-sized LSP or agency. Language Service Provider is LSP. How clients buy, I think you also can get it for free. And Rich Dad Poor Dad is quite old, but it's a good book, like as a starting point. And to sum up, well, excellence is perseverance in the presence of obstacles. So nothing will be easy. Every path of your life will be filled of obstacles, but you have to keep smiling, even though you are getting some punching in the face. Okay. And for more information, you can connect with me, and well, I now will be open to some questions if there is time.
Not much time, because I still want to a few minutes briefer before the next talk. So
I tried to make it shorter, but it was too much to cover. So
maybe just one or two questions.
Can you share the presentation with us?
Yes, I will share the presentation, and I will share links to other things. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach me at LinkedIn. I will share the link in the chat. And be positive and grow and progress. And that's it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. This was very enriching.
Okay, thank you.